Welcome to The Big Break Show, a podcast where we discuss short-term rentals, entrepreneurship, life, mindset, and everything in between. Here are your hosts, Rob Beloza and Jesse Vasquez.
What's up, everybody? Welcome to another episode of The Big Break Show. I'm here with my co-host, Mr. Jesse Vasquez. What is up, Mr. Jesse Vasquez?
What is up, man? Happy Monday. Today's Monday. And yeah, we're on. I wish I could tell you what episode we're on, because that's usually my thing, but I'm not really sure and I don't want to screw it up. So
we lost track.
Yeah, we lost track. That's how many episodes we've done already, guys. So yeah, whatever episode this is, it'll show up there. But we have Craig, who was formerly on BiggerPockets, worked for BiggerPockets, and he wrote a lot of stuff for BiggerPockets, wrote his own book. This dude is a successful real estate entrepreneur. He's also house hacking. That was his huge kind of break in that sense. He teaches about how to house hack. That's what the book is about. And I think it's such a big topic, Rafa, because, you know, it's an easy way to get started into real estate, especially if you have that mindset that somebody else is going to pay for my property while you live on the other side, you know, if you get a duplex or whatnot.
Yeah. And this guy's pretty much the expert on house hacking. And for everybody that doesn't know, right, house hacking, you're going to find out what it is on this episode, because he talks about it briefly and he goes into details, and he's got a book all about it, like you said, Jesse. So I'm excited for you guys to listen to this one. Really good. It's funny because I actually read a lot of his articles back in the day when I first started on BiggerPockets, and I had no idea that it was him who wrote them, because, you know, when you read articles, you just read them and it's either a good read or it's a bad read. And then today when he was talking about it, I was like, oh, I've heard your stories before. Yeah, I remember this. I remember thinking I should do that to get started in real estate. And it was kind of one of the reasons why I decided to do a lot of Airbnb stuff as well. So hopefully you guys enjoy the show. Mr. Craig, without further ado.
What's up, Craig? We have a guest today that is in the real estate business, has been here for quite some time now. And I'm excited to have Craig on here to talk about flipping. I actually found you, Craig, on the gram, man. You were on Instagram. So tell us a little bit about what you have going on, man, what you do in your day-to-day life, and maybe stuff from the beginning that kind of led you into the real estate path and career. So break that down for us.
For sure. Yeah. Jesse and Rafa, thank you so much for having me on the show. So basically, you know, it all started when I was working at a job that I hated, right? I think a lot of us started in that place, and there's just, you know, I thought to myself, there's just no way in hell I would do this for the rest of my life. And so I started thinking about passive income, right? I stumbled upon passive income, you know, tried to think of stupid startup ideas that just wouldn't really work. And then I kind of stumbled into real estate. And real estate was like, well, I don't, you know, it seems relatively easy, pretty straightforward. And, you know, I don't need to be like the famous Mark Zuckerberg or Steve Jobs or Elon Musk or anything like that. You know, I don't need to be famous, but I can still build wealth and change the life of me and my families through passive income and real estate investing. So that's, you know, when I started doing research, I inevitably found BiggerPockets. I feel like all real estate roads lead back to BiggerPockets. And I just started, you know, just absorbing massive amounts of information, probably for about 6 months, 4 or 5 hours a day. I was just, you know, watching the webinars, reading the books, doing all the things that you're supposed to do. And then in about 6 months after learning, I saw that BiggerPockets was hiring. So I applied for the job at BiggerPockets, and weirdly enough, I got the job. And so, you know, you're going to ask me what my big break is. I'd say this was probably my big break. Is when I moved from California at the time in the job that I hated to Denver, where BiggerPockets is located, and, you know, was basically opened up to this world of real estate investing, and that's where it all got started.
Okay, that's awesome. That's an awesome story. So let me ask you, what exactly do you do over at BiggerPockets? I guess we can start it there.
Yeah, so I no longer work there anymore. I worked there for about 3 years. And so at the time, I was their finance person. So basically, you know, I would do all their books and make sure everything checked out and all that stuff. And also, like, you know, I was at BiggerPockets. So everyone at the time, everyone kind of there was talking real estate and all that kind of stuff. And it was super fun. Real estate investing was pretty prominent amongst a lot of the employees. And so they were pretty chill about, you know, me going out and taking a look at properties and all that kind of stuff. And so basically within 2 months of moving to Denver, I had closed on my first house hack. And so if your audience doesn't know what a house hack is, it's when you buy a 1-4 unit property with a low percent down, typically 0-5% down. I did 3.5% down for my first one. I lived in one unit, rented out the others, the rent covered my mortgage, and I'd live for free. And so I was able to do that year over year over year, just getting started in this real estate portfolio, this real estate business, so that I could build a real estate portfolio and, you know, provide the passive income to become financially independent.
Got it. And right now, what's your real estate portfolio look like? Like, can we talk about that for a second?
Yeah. So, you know, fast forward about 5 years later, my portfolio today, I've got, so this is just mine, does not include my wife's, because we kind of built our empire separately. Okay. We have, I've got six properties in Denver. It's about 12 or 13 units. I've got six properties in North Carolina, two in Florida, and then we've also got a place in Idaho here.
That's awesome.
I got a question for you since you saw everybody's payroll over at BiggerPockets. Like, what's Brandon and all these guys making, man? Spill the beans. Don't be shy. Don't be shy. Are they making pretty good cash over there?
I can say, yeah, they're making more than, I don't know if I can disclose, but they're making more than us, I'm sure. So.
I was trying to get trending right now. So if you would have been like, yeah, Brandon makes $5 million every episode, then I would have been like, all right, I got it. Rafa, we're trending. Here it is, big break show. But no, that's cool, man. I expect those guys to make some cash. So I got another controversial subject. Why do you and your wife keep your real estate separate?
Well, so we just got married a couple months ago, so we're not going to keep it separate. Like going forward, we're going to combine it. But because the marriage is so new and I have never thought of it us combined, I can't even think of it that quickly off the cuff.
Did you guys get a prenup?
No, we didn't. No, we're together forever. Like we're going to make it really, we're going to make it really, really hard to get divorced. And so like that's good. We're both really don't believe in it. And so like, we're like, we really have to have a shitty marriage for this not to work. And so that was my theory there. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. No, that makes complete sense. And I get it, man. So that's, you have like a really fascinating story. So tell us about like what you did in your first deal, your first house hack. I'm assuming that's what you did for your first place. I mean, you just brought that up. So what did that look like?
Yeah. So this was back in 2017. So, you know, keep that in mind when I tell you the prices. So this was a up down duplex, about a mile and a half from the office in Denver, in this kind of up and coming part of Denver, which frankly, I was so new to Denver, I didn't even know it was up and coming. It was actually kind of sketchy at the time. But I bought it for $385,000. I lived in the bottom and rented out the top. My mortgage payment was about $2,200. I rented the top for $1,750 and I lived in the bottom. I really, really, really was determined to make my, to live for free, but that clearly wasn't doing it. So what I did was I rented out my bedroom on Airbnb and I slept basically like on the couch in the living room. I put up like a curtain and a room divider for a little bit of privacy. But that was it. And so that Airbnb was making $1,100 a month. So total rent on that property while I was living there was $2,850 a month. And my mortgage was like $2,200 or so. So, you know, I was making $600 over the mortgage plus living for free. And it was definitely a life-changing kind of thought.
You know, I think I've heard your story before, Craig. I think you've mentioned it somewhere because I'm big on BiggerPockets. Like I started listening to BiggerPockets back in like 2015. And so it's also what got my ball rolling for like, you know, investing and stuff like that. So I just took the short-term rental route over the actual property route. But I've heard it before and it's fascinating because a lot of people think, you know, Airbnb started as like a couch surfing website, right? Like that's really what it was way back in the day. And nobody ever really uses it for that. And they don't see the power behind it. Like you just said, like you literally were paying for everything by renting out the rest of your house and living in one part of it, right? And that generates so much revenue that you could really, anybody listening to this could live for free, even if they don't have multiple units in their property, right? Like you can rent out the bedrooms, you can rent out the couch, you can put up a curtain, you can divide the living room, whatever you want. And you get to meet a lot of interesting people. Was that uncomfortable for you while you were doing that in the beginning?
The first couple were just because, you know, I wasn't really used to people I didn't know, like walking by me while I slept. You know, I think once you start talking to people, you realize that a lot of people who are traveling, they're like super nice people. And I like to travel a lot too. So we end up having a lot in common. So, you know, like once I got used to it, no, it was awesome. I mean, I made some really good friendships, probably, you know, probably three or four of the people that stayed in my place, like I'm still in touch with today.
Craig, so you never actually woke up and had somebody 3 inches from your face just staring at you while you're sleeping?
Yeah, no one like breathing in my face. Like I didn't wake up to any bad breath or anything like that. So
yeah,
at least no one else's bad breath.
When I sleep, Rafa's like literally 3 inches from my face. Like I wake up and the dude's just sitting there staring at me. So
that's your wake up call. Yeah. It's accountability, man.
That's because he keeps his phone near his face. So I'm always FaceTiming him to make sure he's on point with everything.
Yeah.
Oh, that's awesome, man. So that was an uncomfortable feeling at first, but then you got used to it. But then the cash flow, I'm assuming you were relatively pretty young at that point, right? So you're kind of just like, whatever, I'm going with the flow.
Yeah. And so I recognize that. So I was 24 at the time and I was like, well, I'm 24, I'm single. I might as well take advantage of the situation because there's no other time in my life where I'm going to be able to like do this. So, you know, I did it. I slummed it for a year, and then the next, and that allowed me to save up. So in exactly 1 year later, I was able to buy the next property. And then that's kind of where the, you know, the snowball starts.
So right now, are you currently purchasing one property per year, or how does that look like now? Well, okay, I guess you're two different people now back then to today. But when you started, I'm assuming, can we talk about how like you transitioned into your actual business now and what you're doing now? Is it like one property per year? How does it look like? What is it that you have going on?
Yeah, so with house hacking, with the way it starts is you typically start buying one property a year, right? You're basically saving up that next, at least in Denver, it was like 30 grand, like save up another 30 grand. And that took about a year. And then I would, you know, rinse and repeat. Obviously, as you start to have more real estate and you start to become financially independent, take more entrepreneurial ventures, you're able to make more money, more than you'll ever be able to spend. And so then you start investing in different things. And so, you know, now I've got investments in a couple different places. Like I mentioned, I bought, you know, six properties out in North Carolina, a couple down in Florida. So kind of just kind of all around the country. I'm kind of not, so house hacking, I'm done house hacking now. I've done 5-6 house hacks. I'm done with that. And now we are in our forever home. Now we're looking to potentially, you know, do some commercial investing, right? Like kind of level up.
You know, I love how that works, how you're saying I'm done with house hacking now, right? Why are you done with house hacking?
Yeah, it's just, there's a time and a place for house hacking, right? I think it's an amazing thing to build a foundation, right? You know, I think you can make your first million house hacking, no problem. But what got you to your first million may not make you your second, third, fifth, tenth. Right. And so, you know, there's a book, what got you here, what won't get you there. And so again, house hacking is great, but it's not very scalable. And so also, you know, I'm almost 29 and a half, 30 now, like I'm married. And so now it's like, okay, like we kind of want to settle down. Like this was just the foundation. And now we've got a beautiful home. We actually still rent out our basement because we're going to grow into the home. We don't have kids or anything yet. So we still kind of house hack. And yeah. And so now it's like, okay, how do we like now take this business and scale it? And so, you know, now what we've done is we've built a team of real estate agents. I'm a licensed agent in Denver. And we've got a team of agents that coach, guide, and mentor people through this house hacking process because it's scary doing it alone. And so now we're able to help the masses achieve the same thing that I've achieved.
Do you see a lot of like millennials, younger people that are getting into this? Because like this wasn't really a thing when I was younger. Like I'm, you know, 10 years older than you. You know, when I was 18, 19, 20, there wasn't really a house. It wasn't actually as accessible as it is now. We obviously didn't have social media and stuff. Except for MySpace, which you're probably too young for that.
I had a MySpace. I got in trouble for being on MySpace. Yeah.
All right. Maybe I'm not that. Maybe I am old, but maybe you're a little bit old too. But you know how like nowadays it's just a 20-something-year-old kid can literally save 30 grand, 40 grand. You can't buy in Denver. You can't buy in Florida anymore. You can't buy in California for that. But there's a whole other, you know, 30-something states that you probably could buy something like that in. So do you see that? Is that who you're catering to more now? Or is it kind of a mixture of people?
So we're seeing that you can definitely still buy in Denver. You can buy in these like tier two cities like Denver, Seattle, Austin, you know, like LA, San Francisco, New York, Chicago, probably not. But like these cities of like Denver, Austin, Seattle, you can 100% buy. You know, you're not buying in the city. You might be, but you could also buy in the suburbs, which is maybe, you know, maybe you're 10, 15 minutes out from downtown, but you can still buy a house for $400,000, $500,000, maybe $600,000. And the thing is people want to live in these cities. So you can do rent by the room, you can do Airbnb, and you can make good money from doing those strategies, right? And so you really have to just take a look at your market and just take what your market gives you.
Yeah. Yeah. I love that. I think it's one of the easiest ways to get in. And, you know, like I have a daughter that's 18 right now, and I'm telling her, like, save money now. And she's got 30 grand saved up. You know, I helped her with some stocks and stuff early on. And, you know, she's going to college, JC, right now. And I'm like, this is exactly what you need to do as you get your first place, like house hack, get a duplex, you live in one, and then you Airbnb the other. Like literally you're going to be living for free. Like there's no way around it. You 100% or midterm rent it, have a travel nurse in there, or, you know, somebody that comes in for 90 days at a time that can live there and then they're going to bounce out. You only need four of those a year, only four of those guests a year. And that's all you got to deal with. You don't have to deal with turnover. You don't deal with any of that stuff. So it's such a smart way. And you have to really want to do that to get into it and really start thinking about it. Just like you said, bigger pockets. You have a podcast too. I'm not sure if you want to go ahead and talk about that. But yeah, I mean, there's such a good opportunity, especially for the younger people that are looking to buy something.
Yeah. I mean, nowadays, right, there's just so much information out there, right? And so, yeah, there's BiggerPockets. You know, our podcast is Investify. And it's just so like, and we just educate people on how to, you know, like beginner investors, really, how to get started. And like, let's talk about your first deal. Let's talk about your second deal and how you scaled up and all those things. And yeah, like there's so much information that if you want to achieve financial independence, if you're listening to this and you're, you know, in your 20s or 30s, no matter however old you are, like if you want to retire in 5 years, like this is a tried and true method. It's been done countless times and it works. And so it's not like, you know, you're not like throwing money at Bitcoin and praying that it goes up or buying an NFT of a monkey and hoping that goes up. Like, you know, maybe it will, right? I'm not crapping on those investments or whatever you want to call them, but like this is like tried and true. It's worked, you know, hundreds, thousands, probably tens of thousands of times for people all over the country. And you just got to stick to it.
Yeah, I love that, man. It's a really secure way for people to secure their future, right? Okay, so I want to go back to the part where we were talking about, and I brought up the, you know, why you're not doing any more house hacking is because, you know, I was saying I love the way it works because when you get to a point of where you've done it and you've gotten really good at it, you always got to get to that next level, right? What's that next level for you? I know you said you're looking at commercial property. Are we talking like offices or are we talking like apartment complexes?
Right now, we're focusing more on apartment complexes. And we may even acquire like a portfolio of single families and treat that like a commercial deal. But right now, we're looking at kind of like residential apartment complexes. You know, we've got a couple of partners. We're looking in Kentucky and in Colorado. And we're just, you know, we're going to take it day by day. And if other investment opportunities come, we're open to them. But I think our focus right now is this multifamily stuff.
And is that like you and your wife together or is it just like you and your team?
It's me and my team. So my wife is kind of like, you know, she like did her thing. She's got a few house hacks herself and all that. But she's, you know, she's a real estate agent. And she's kind of like slowing down a little bit as we, you know, start to make the house the home and start to think about having kids and all that. But really, she's still like most of her time now is still focused just being kind of like a realtor and having some supplemental income for us.
Got it. Okay.
Where's your income coming from now? Is it your, you know, all your properties or is it real estate or is it like 50-50?
Most of it is from our team, you know, the real estate team that, you know, we help investors and house hackers and all that buy properties in the greater Denver area. And then also, you know, we've got rental properties and, you know, some book royalties and stuff like that as well. But most of it is going to be the team. And then second is rental properties.
So do you work for EXP where you have that like tiered, if they make a sale, you get an earning off that?
Yep, exactly. So, yep, the EXP's got kind of like the multi-level marketing feel to it, which is wonderful because it is passive income, which is nice.
Yeah, and it's forever. So all those realtors that are looking to get started, EXP is probably where I've seen the biggest heavy hitters. Shane Rafa, we just had on one of my buddies in the Santa Cruz area, does the exact same thing. And, you know, they make he makes pretty decent money. I think he's got like 25 guys and gals that are on his team now. And, you know, that area, it's $1 million properties. Like there's nothing less than that. So it's crazy the amount of income that you can make just by building a team, but you got to be well known. You got to be respected in those markets and, you know, bring, you know, start a team that way.
Yeah. It's not easy, right? It's not like you can just like become a realtor with EXP and then have everyone just swarm to you and right. But you have to like provide some value and it's not, you know, it's passive, but it's not that bad. I mean, it is passive technically, like, but there's a lot of upfront work that needs to be done to create the passivity to it.
Hey, Craig, I want to ask you about your book, man. Can we talk about that for a second? Like, what's it about? I'm not familiar with it at all, which is why I'm asking. And then how did it come about?
Yeah, so it's called The House Hacking Strategy, believe it or not. yeah, and so basically it's basically like your step-by-step guide to a house hack, right? So from picking your market to finding your team to analyzing the deal to getting your tenants placed to whatever, you know, how it can help you, like, you know, basically your step-by-step guide to that. And so, the book came out in 2019, and it's published through BiggerPockets. And so that basically came about because, BiggerPockets kind of was looking for someone to write a house hacking book. They went to Brandon first, but Brandon was too busy starting his Open Door Capital, which is his like multifamily or his syndication thing with mobile homes and multifamily. And then Scott Trench was going to write it, but he was too busy being CEO of BiggerPockets. And so then I was the third option and I was like, hell yeah, I'll write it. So, that's how it all came to be.
So do they get a back end portion of that then? Or is it like your book?
So it is published to them. So yeah, they get a cut and I get a cut and yeah.
Got you. Yeah, but I mean, to have representation from them, to have them backing you, I mean, that's like, people look at Bigger Pockets. So like, that's awesome to have that kind of backing, you know, on that.
Oh yeah. I mean, that was that book just totally changed my life. Like just getting that published, getting on the podcast, you know, that really jumpstarted the real estate agent team. It jumpstarted like pretty much everything. And so, yeah, that book was probably one of the best things that I was able to do. Best opportunity I've had.
Craig, tell me, how did the book actually impact you, like your life, and what did it do for you?
Yeah, so the book had a tremendous impact on my life, right? And so basically it gave me not only the credibility that I was the expert in house hacking and that I could be trusted and basically be able to trust it and helping other people get their house hacks, which helped with the real estate agent team. But it also gave me a platform to go on a bunch of different podcasts and give me like credibility to go on these podcasts just like yours, right? Like I was on Bigger Pockets and Bigger Pockets a couple times. I was on a couple other pretty big ones. And that was just able to, you know, get me the, what's it called?
Clout.
Yeah, there you go. The clout and the recognition. Yeah. The clout and the recognition in the space. And it just, it really helped just jumpstart, you know, my career with real estate investing and with, it was helping other people do the same.
Yeah. You know, it's like instant credibility, right? Anybody who sees that, when they see you, they'll go, oh my God, this is the guy. He's the guy that knows what he's talking about because he wrote this book that's published by Bigger Pockets, which is where I go to listen to any type of real estate advice, right? So that's awesome, man. Yeah, I love that. That's really cool. So, okay. So let's talk about where you were, where you're at now, and where you're going forward, right? So you started house hacking. You did it for a couple of years. You got a couple under your belt. You're doing the real estate agent thing, right? You're building an empire now in real estate. How does the future look for you? Like, what do you have planned aside from just the commercial real estate? Like, what's your plans? What's your goals from where you started to where you're at now? And how, I know I'm asking a lot of questions, but bear with me. We'll go one at a time. So the first one is, what's the future look like for you? And what are your goals in terms of what you got going on? But how did those goals change as you grew in your real estate journey is what I really want to know. From going from house hacking to now saying, I want multifamily.
Yeah. So the first goal, right, was just to hit baseline financial independence, right? You have, you know, $5,000-$6,000 a month of passive income and you're able to cover your baseline expenses and you feel good about that. Once you hit that level, you no longer are working. I no longer need to work a W-2 job. I'm no longer playing not to lose. I'm playing to win. That's when I started my real estate team, which was a risk, quote unquote, right? I didn't know it was going to succeed or not. And so, you know, then we started the real estate team. And now my focus is on helping our agents just absolutely crush it in the real estate space, helping all of our clients get their first, second, third house hacks. And, you know, just working on ways to help that grow. And so now what our personal goals are is really I'm looking to kind of like, you know, continue to grow, but not be in a rush to do so, right? Like, you know, I don't want to let life pass by and be, you know, 50, 60 years old and be like, oh, wow, I have like $100 million, but I missed a bunch of memories through the last 20 years, right? And so like what's the most important thing, right? It's, you know, doing these things, experiences and relationships, I think are the two most important things. And so, you know, I'm working to build my relationships, making sure I spend quality time with my wife, quality time with my family, my friends, doing trips, just creating experiences, doing an Ironman in a couple of weeks. And so like that is a big thing that I'm trying to do. So I'm kind of just looking to live a little bit more of a balanced life.
Okay, let's pause for a second because I want to do an Ironman and we've been talking about this since like the last episode. I'm actually looking for a coach right now for an Ironman. So I don't want to sidetrack because I get excited when we talk about things that I can relate with people with. So, okay, first of all, the experiences thing is huge, right? Being able to enjoy things with the people around you to me is one of the biggest, greatest feelings in the world, right? Like there's nothing better. I don't care if I have this $40 billion house and I haven't done anything for the past 10 years with the people I love. Like it's pointless. You know what I mean? And so
100%.
Experiences to me, or at least enjoying things that you can enjoy with those around you, is probably one of the greatest feelings around. And I think that when people first start off, it's always about, hey, I need to make a lot of money, right? Oh my God, I need to cover my bills, which is how everybody should pretty much be, right? How can you cover your way of living? What do you need to get to that point where you're already no longer needing to rely on another company to pay for your check? But then when you get to a point, it's when do you really stop and say, hey, I've gone here. Okay. Now it's really time to enjoy life where it's at. It's not just grind, 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 hustle, 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 make a bunch of money, collect, 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 build, build, build. And then, like you said, be 55 years old. When did you realize that, hey, I think we're at a good time in our lives where let's just enjoy life. Let's slow it down a little bit. Let's still work, but let's enjoy as much as we can.
Probably, you know, I knew I hit there about a year ago, but I haven't really started taking actionable steps probably until the last couple months. I really hit this thing where it's like, why am I working so hard? Like, I don't have to. So I basically stopped setting an alarm clock. I wake up whenever. I wake up when the sun gets up. So, you know, usually around 5:36. And I do my whole miracle morning thing. And I do have the same routine, but it's on my schedule, right? I try to schedule most of my calls for the afternoons. And my mornings are pretty slow. I pretty much try to get off at work 3 or 4 and then kind of do whatever the day asks me to do from there, right? Sometimes I go for a workout if I don't do it in the morning. Sometimes I just hang out with my wife. Sometimes I do some stuff around the house, right? It's just like, I don't need to work as hard anymore because that, like, I don't, that's why I worked so hard in the first 5 years, the last 5 years, is so I don't have to work hard forever. And so now I'm kind of, it's just, and it's uncomfortable, dude. It's really uncomfortable. Like, not working hard and seeing other people like achieving these big things. But you have to just realize that you can't compare yourself to other people and you have to figure out what will make you happy. And so my wife and I did this exercise where we're like, okay, like how much passive income do we really think we need to like be set and like not ever have to even think about worrying about it? And we came to the number like maybe 20 or 25 grand and we're not there yet. We're probably somewhere between 10 and 15. Yeah, a month. Got you. So we're not there yet, right? We're between 10 and 20, 10 and 15, but we don't have to sprint there at this point, right? We can kind of get there slowly over the next 5 or 10 years and enjoy our life while we do it. Because once you get there, then what? You're not just going to retire and stop, right? Then you're going to have another bogey that you're going to want to hit. And so now it's kind of just like, you know, enjoy the journey and don't just keep wanting more and more and more, but like, you know, stop doing things you don't want to do.
Yeah, Craig, I love that, man. I love that because I'm reading right now. I'm about to finish it. It's called The Gap and the Gain. Yep. And great book, right? Because so many people are always like successful people who get to a point and they're like, I need more. I need more. I need to get there. I need to get there. And it's like, well, when you get there, what? You've already wasted the last 40 years of your life. Now what, right? It's like, did you at least enjoy what you were doing in the middle? That's how I was when I first started. I'm still like that. I have a really hard time slowing myself down and enjoying where we're at.
You are like that. I think I'm like that too. We've talked about this on the show before, where it's like you want to hit this goal and then you hit it. And then all of a sudden it's just like, what's the next step? Like, what's the next goal? And like I don't even feel happy about those goals. I'll hit them for a second. And then it's just like, boom, what's the next one? Instead of actually like soaking in that, living in that moment. We talked to the founder of Furnish Finders. And this guy has like a million subscribers every month. The CEO. And he's just like, yeah, you celebrate these moments, you enjoy them, and then you just move on to the next one. Like, it can disappear in any second. Like, everything that you're doing can just be gone just like that. And I think sometimes we forget to slow down, be mindful, really appreciate those moments that we have. Because, you know, as entrepreneurs, our mindset is always, what's the next thing? What's the next thing? And I think, Rafa, for you and for me, I see that both, you know, you and I are similar and different in a lot of ways, but we're both similar in that aspect where it's like, go, 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 go. How do we get to this next thing? You probably wake up in the middle of the night and think about, oh crap, I need to do this or do that. Like, I do that. Like, I need to not do that. You know what I mean? But Craig, it sounds like you're figuring this out and you're learning how to do it. And I think everybody listening right now really need to think about that stuff. In real estate, it's not a get rich quick. I mean, Craig just said he spent 5 years to get to 10 or 15K of passive income. That's not overnight at all in any thought at all. It's a long-term game. And I think that, you know, Instagram and YouTube and all these things teach people that it's instant gratification. In reality, it's not that way. Real estate is a long-term game. It's not short.
Yeah. You know, so a couple of things that I realized based on kind of what you're saying is like, I think you really need to just like take a step back and just figure out what your why is. And you have to like, and if it's like, I want to hang out with Rafa, who's got $10 million net worth, then I only have a $5 million net worth and I got to catch up to him, right? Like, it's your wrong reason, right? Wrong reason. If Rafa doesn't like you because of your net worth, he's not a good friend, right? And so like, you need to get rid of those people and you need to be around people that just authentically like you for who you are. And again, you grow your business slowly. And another thing I just heard recently, it was like a quote from Winnie the Pooh, which is kind of funny, but there's something like profound about Winnie the Pooh. I feel like he's got a lot of like wisdom. He's like, you know what the best feeling in the world is when you first take that first bite of honey. And then he takes a step back and he says, actually, no, the first feeling, the best feeling in the world is just before you have that first bite of honey. Because once you have that bite of honey, you're looking forward to the next bite, right? And then you have the diminishing return. And so it's like, you know, you're looking for that next paycheck, you're looking for that next sale. The most exciting point is just before it, not necessarily after you've got it. Because once after you've got it, you're now looking to the next thing. So I thought that was a pretty, like, I was like, holy shit. Yeah, that makes sense. And so I think just like enjoy where you are. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, Gary Vee says this too. Gary Vee always talks about, you know, the grind, the process. Enjoy the process, because that's where it takes those little incremental steps, daily activities, daily, you know, that continuity of doing things and consistency, that's where the enjoyment's at. And like Gary Vee always pushes that stuff, you know, like that's what you got to love. And really at the end of the day, it's like, we're looking for results, not the daily individual grinds, the calling the clients, talking to people, joining podcasts, you know, it's different. So,
you know, what really changed it for me too, Craig, talking about this, was I could never figure out my why. In the beginning, a lot, you know, everybody always says, oh, it's family, it's kids, you know, it's, and everybody has a different one. But for me, like for a long time, it was like, I don't really know what it is. There's just like, I don't have children, right? I'm not married. I have a girlfriend now. And so when I came down to it, after doing a lot of thinking and talking about it, it was control of my time. That's my why. I really want to have control of my time. I want to pick and choose who I spend my time with, what I do with these people, where I go with them, all because I can, right? I can pick and choose and say, hey, today on Tuesday, 10 a.m., I can go wherever the heck I want without any restraints of anybody behind me. That was big, right? The second part was, in order to get there, it was nonstop. Hey, you got to work, you got to work, you got to go to work, you got to work. And it's like grind, 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 grind. And it was never enough. It was like, okay, I got this. Where could I got this money. What can I do with this money? Let's go put it somewhere else. All right, now I've gotten here. What can I do to make more? And then I go put it somewhere else. And then I realized, well, me doing that is not really taking control of my time. It's me just working for something more and more and more and more. And what really changed it was that book, The Gap in the Gain, which is one of my favorite books now because I've read it. I'm almost done with it, actually. And I realized that, hey, if you stop, you take a second, okay, and you just look around you and you see what you've accomplished, right? I forgot what he calls it, but it's that past measure, what you've accomplished from today to the last year. And he starts off with the month, right? 30 days. 90 days, 6 months, and then a year. And you see what you've accomplished and how far you've gone. You're like, holy crap. I guess I can slow it down and kind of enjoy these wins for the past year. And now if you stop and you slow down, for me, I actually do have control of my time now, right? I have passive income coming in, right? My business is fully automated. I can pick and choose to do whatever I want. And it's very difficult for a lot of people to understand that in order to get to where you need to go, you don't need to measure yourself against someone else, just like you were saying, Craig, right? You don't need to measure yourself against, you know, the big guys in the world, right? You need to measure yourself against yourself to where you want to go to accomplish that why of why you're doing this specific task. For me, it's control of my time. So what do I need to do to get control of my time? Well, I really just need to generate enough revenue to maybe go on a couple trips a year, to cover all my expenses every month without having anybody behind me telling me what I have to do and where I have to be, right? So that's a big, big deal. And that's why I wanted to bring it up. So Craig, okay, I know we're running short on time here. So I want to get to, before we get to our final questions here, tell us a little bit about what you got going on with the commercial side of things. Because I know you're talking about building the real estate empire that you've got going on with all your agents, but you've also slowed down to enjoy your life a little bit. So how does it look right now in terms of shift? Like, do you still wake up and work really like every day, or do you take a couple days off? Because I want to know how it's going to look for you getting forward to this whole commercial, because everybody's always got to have some kind of goal, right? That you can measure against. Like, how does that look for you specifically? Does my question make sense?
No, yeah, for sure. Yeah. So basically, you know, I started off in this business and I was writing every contract, showing every house, talking to every client, you know, setting up every closing, all that. It was all me, right? And then just like, you know, the E-Myth, right? You kind of like start extracting yourself through the things from the tasks you don't like to do by hiring other people. And so now, again, we empower our agents who are all house hackers and investors and all that. And they are the ones showing the houses, writing the contracts and all that. My role now is just to keep the lead funnel going, right? And so it's coming on shows like this to get the word out there. It's, you know, we're expanding into the residential space now too. Okay, like how do I grow and grow this team, keep them accountable so that they're hitting their goals and they're achieving their financial goals and they can put food on the table for their families as well. And so now it becomes more, I'm more in like a leadership position versus a just like, I'm working on the business versus in the business, right? Like it's exactly what I'm doing. And I probably work a little bit each day, but I don't work a single 8-hour day a week. I probably start my day right around 10 and maybe get off around 2 or 3. Some days a little longer, some days a little shorter, right? Last Friday I took off and I did a 70-mile bike ride and a 7-mile run, right? Because I'm training for this Ironman. And so like, yeah, that takes like 6 hours. So that's what I did. And I can do that because, you know, that's what you built.
So Craig, was that difficult for you? I want to talk about the Ironman still, so I'm not going to forget about that. But was it difficult for you about getting to that point where you don't have to do anything all day? Like for me, it's very hard for me to sit still and say, hey, like, because I beat myself up at the end of the day and I go, man, I didn't do any work today, or man, I only got this little bit of work done today. Like, is that difficult for you to overcome that?
It is difficult for sure. But and it's a mindset shift of like, I'm intentionally doing this. Like this, I didn't do any work today, and that's a good thing because this is like recharging me. Or the work that I do, that I do in my day, I make sure that I'm productive, right? Like how much of your day are you on your email or on social media or whatever, right? It's like, no, you I set a goal like, all right, like I'm going to script and record 7 TikToks today, right? And this is literally a thing that I have to do once a week. And so like, within an hour, I can script and record 7 TikToks because like that is the only thing I do. And then at the end of the day, I'll check my email once, and that's my response to email time. And so like, you know, the time blocking and that, and just making sure you're efficient and using your time wisely, I think is a huge, also a huge part of it.
Time blocking was difficult for me. I'm getting very comfortable with it now. I calendar everything, literally calendar everything now because of that. Okay, let's talk about this Ironman. Yeah, can we?
So, let's do it.
All right. Why did you choose to do an Ironman? Because I know they're difficult. And what made you want to go, hey, I want to put myself through this?
So I committed last August, maybe. So it's been a while. It's been like 9-10 months. And I was just I was craving something hard that required discipline. I felt like I was lacking that at the time. Like, you know, I go kind of through these ups and downs of like, man, I haven't done anything hard in a while. I haven't like consistently done something to achieve a larger goal. Right before, it was like sleeping on my couch, it was biking to work, it was doing my miracle morning every morning and all that. And I felt like I lost some of my discipline. And so one of my buddies was basically just like, yo, you should do an Ironman. And I was like, no, I hate running. Why would I do an Ironman? I hate running. And he's like, well, that's why you should do it. And I was like, no, I don't want to do it. I don't want to run for the next 10 months. And then he's like, well, you know, we have these things in Colorado called 14ers, which are like these mountains at 14,000 feet. And I love climbing those. And he's like, well, if you can do one of those, you can definitely do an Ironman. You just got to, you know, you're just going to have to train. And I was like, all right, fine. So I just embraced it, embraced the suck of running. Biking has been fun. Swimming has been fun. But running, just I hate it. And, you know, it's been a journey, right? It's been a journey of just discipline every single, you know, not every day because you need rest days, but like every week. For sure, I'm doing a long ride, a long run, and some, you know, sporadic stuff in between. And yeah, now I've got to where I can pretty comfortably ride probably 100 miles and run 10, 15 miles, and it's not a huge deal. So
I love that, Craig. That's exactly why I want to sign up for mine, because I feel like I need something to keep me in line with everything else, right? Because I'm kind of like all over the place, and I feel like if I stick to something, that's going to make me do something every single day, right? Today I'm going to ride my bike for an hour just so I can get started, because today's day one for me. I started meal prepping literally last week, so I can start getting comfortable with having 5 small meals a day. I'm fasting between 11 and 7. So it's going to take a lot of discipline. And I'm the type of person who likes to go out on the weekends with friends, which sucks because I'm no longer going to be able to do that. But again, it goes back to the discipline side of things, right? To make sure that you're focused. And for me, the reason why I want to do it is because I want to try something very difficult that's going to get my mind from, hey, if I can accomplish this, what else can I do going forward, right? Because what if I can? So thanks for sharing that, man. We're getting to the top of the hours here, so I want to respect your time. Let me ask you the two questions we ask everybody, right? Our segment here, being that this is the Big Break Show. Tell us, I mean, you kind of gave a little hint earlier, but your big break in life that got you from being old Craig to new Craig, or that made you shift your mindset, or that just made you realize and go, huh, this, thanks to this one thing, I am where I am today.
Yeah. I mean, so I guess like the pre big break was getting the job at BiggerPockets, which I told you about, because that eventually it allowed me to write for their blog. So I wrote like 50 or so articles for their blog. And that, and because of that, they gave me the opportunity to write the book on house hacking. And so the house hacking book was the true big break for sure. But that would never have happened without the job at BiggerPockets and just being there consistently writing and kind of being for free, not on BiggerPockets hours, right? Like on my own time, I was writing for their blog, and that just, you know, totally catapulted my career.
Did you, Craig, that's awesome. Were you a financial advisor or something before?
I was an analyst at a company that did venture debt, which is basically like hard money loans for startup companies.
Got you. Okay, cool. So I was trying to figure out, how did you get into do the books for BiggerPockets? Because that's essentially what got you there, right? Was doing their books.
Yep. It's because so BiggerPockets was thinking about going through a transaction, right? Selling. And because I had experience analyzing companies that were selling or were about to sell or whatever, they thought that I would be a good fit. And then, you know, BiggerPockets, you know, went through the whole thing. And now, you know, I kind of helped with that. So I did my job.
Got you. What do you think about the new co-host of BiggerPockets?
David and who's the other guy? Rob or something? I've never met Rob in person. And to be honest, I haven't listened too much to the since they left. But I'm sure it's great. I know David does a good job, and I'm sure BiggerPockets did their research and picked wisely. So
definitely, man. That's awesome. Yeah, I think that's a perfect big break. And that's like the big break that people typically think about. It's like, I got this one job, that one specific thing that was able to kind of catapult me forward. So now one of the other questions we ask is an actionable step that somebody could take today from listening to this episode, something that you've either brought through inspiration or through something you've had through trials and tribulations that somebody could do today to get started in whatever it is that they're doing.
That's a good question. I always say the first step is education, but the second step is just start meeting people, because the people you meet are the ones that are going to give you your big break. And you can't get lucky by sitting on your couch and listening to podcasts all day and reading books all day. You have to start meeting people that make things happen. So if you want to come on the show and get your own big break, I would say just get out and start meeting people.
It's funny how we have a trending topic. Everybody we bring on always says it's about relationships and meeting people. And it's 100% true. My business is catapulted tenfold just by going out and putting myself out there and meeting people. So yeah, man, Craig, thanks for coming on the show. Now, before we get off here, tell us, where can people get a hold of you if they have any other like super hard questions that they want to ask you or they want to reach out to you?
Yeah. So you can reach out to me on Instagram. I'm the Fi Guy on Instagram. You can follow me on TikTok as well, the Fi Guy, but I do most of my stuff on Instagram. Our team is called the Fi Team, and we got a podcast. It's called Invest to Fi. So we talk about, you know, real estate and about people's financial independence journeys on that show. So
awesome, man.
You guys check out his IG, because he's got some really good content on there that gives you really bite-sized information that you can digest in a short amount of time. That's what that's how I found you, man. So check out his Instagram. He's got some really good stuff on there. Everybody listening right now, we appreciate you all for being here. Please like and subscribe to this channel if you're watching it on YouTube, and leave us a review on Spotify or Apple Podcasts. But Craig, we appreciate you for being here, man. It's been fantastic. I think this has been an excellent episode for people that can learn how to start off house hacking, which I think is huge, especially now since a lot of house prices are kind of outrageous. And it's a good way to bring income in without having to pay your own mortgage. So awesome, man. We appreciate you for being here.
100%, guys. Thanks so much for having me on. It's been a pleasure. We'll talk
soon. Thank you, Craig. Yeah, thanks, brother. Appreciate it.
Thanks, man.